All right, so I think we're here. We can. This discussion is a general discussion. I think Andrew understands the background a little bit better because we've talked a little bit more. But in general, we were just talking as a committee in the fall, and we have a little bit more time, and we're not focused on the FY 17-18-19 budget to kind of take a look at some of the bigger picture items that we don't have time to talk about once we get into the details. So this is like the basic thought here was, let's just think about what we spend most of our money on and how we can be, you know, how we are smart about spending that money and how we can be maybe a little smarter. So basically we had a meeting where we just brainstormed up these questions to say, you know, these are some queries that we have, these are some thought exercises that we were thinking through in terms of, you know, how do you make things work this way? Because as, you know, as outlined very well and clearly last night by Andrew, we are in a situation where, you know, the town's basically buys labor. If you were looking at it as a corporation, you'd say this town is a corporation that buys labor and sells services. And the price for those services has a cap on it of basically 2.5%, give or take a few percentiles. And it can vary. But a lot of the inputs that go into it in terms of labor costs and OPEB and pension and healthcare costs, all those service costs are rising rather quickly. And so I think it just be a useful exercise. We thought as a committee it would be a useful exercise to, you know, talk for a little while about how we best deploy those resources. Is that pretty much the decent table setter?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so we thought it would be great to bring you both in because obviously, Dr. Price, you, your department has the most heads in town.
Sure.
And since Mr. Mailer and yourself have been working closely on a lot of cost-saving initiatives, and you know, you're really at the intersection of the shared services model, where the, you know, where we have centralized functions that work for both town and school, and it seems pretty clear that it's helped both, in, you know, or at least it's
in
helped both
cases.
Over time. And so, you know, we want to start the conversation there, and talk about how has this worked, how has the combining worked, what else is on the table, you know, how does that allow you to do other things. So I think we can start there and then, you know, basically questions one and two and then move from there.
First, you have the history.
Great.
I just have the most recent history.
So when I arrived, we had started some years earlier. I started my fifth year anniversary is next week. So time does fly. When I began, the shared services model had begun in the area of facilities and in information technology primarily, and procurement. And those are our longest lasting or serving joint services functions. They've evolved over time, and I think that's what we're finding both Dr. Price and I and certainly her predecessors as the models evolve. So we have a community conversation or a stakeholder conversation about a service which may make sense to combine. So let's use information technology as an example. And then it's a little organic. We put all of those folks sort of into a joint pot, and then we start to manage through it, navigate through it to try to figure out what best works and what doesn't work. And I think it's incumbent that we begin the conversation by recognizing that everything is worth a try and not everything will be a success. So I think that's been our experience and will continue to be our experience as we move forward. If this group or our respective boards have suggestions or others about things we can try, I think you have found us to be willing partners as in an effort to try things that some communities wouldn't necessarily be willing to, or boards like this in some cases would even be impediments to that. But we also have to recognize that it doesn't always work. We can talk about that to some extent. So the IT one is actually a really interesting example because it has evolved fairly dramatically over time. It was first looked at as a very top-down, strict organizational structure, like you created this independent IT shop, and that everything fell under an IT director and sat sort of in the middle between school operation and town function. What's happened over time is that it's not quite that what happens, for instance, in educational technology is a niche in some ways, and what happens in municipal technology may not be, but it is different, and that what's evolved as a model over time for us, and it works very, very effectively, is that the town, so using a general government side, the general government really serves as providing a service to the municipal departments and also serves as a service provider almost on a contract basis to the school department. So in essence, the network piece, working most commonly under the direction of the municipal IT director, provides service to the plug inside the classrooms. And then a specialist or specialized staff, what I would refer to as specialized staff, with a background in educational technology and the like, a school IT director, I'm not sure the exact term, Mike Grant, but and his supporting sort of staff, they take that connection to the wall in the classroom and they deliver it to the classroom computer and classroom technology. And what we found is that has worked better than the original model where there was one IT director trying to understand municipal technology, the infrastructure of what former Superintendent Chris Hoddle called the fifth utility, and the piece that is the service component to the classroom. And so we've gone from that strict model sort of prior to my arrival to this this newer generation over the last couple of years, and I think we've found a sweet spot where it works. But it's taken us
a while.
Yeah, I don't know when you first did this, but it's close to, you know, eight years maybe. It's taken us to get to this point.
And there's some real benefits to that. I mean, just an example, last year is we were having an issue with the firewall. So the firewall is an extremely expensive thing to do. And we were running all of our traffic from the schools through the firewall, every kid's handheld device, every Chromebook, as we're getting more. And we were looking at about a $200,000 expenditure to get a firewall that could handle the traffic. And the reality of the situation is the vast majority of the traffic was from the schools. Because we have the vast majority of people and teenagers and, you know, and Chris McClure, who's the ID director from the general municipal side, basically, and Mike Grant spent days trying to figure it out. And it was finally Chris who said, we don't need to protect every kid's device from a firewall. Right? I mean, that's not our job. Our job is to only protect that what we need. So we fixed the whole thing by putting routers in the fire station. I mean, I know that this is, but if we didn't work together, we wouldn't have come up with this much cheaper solution that protected the town, because we need to have a firewall for private information, anything that's on Munis, payroll information. But we don't need a firewall for every aspect of our technology. We need a content filter for our kids, but we don't need a firewall protecting their devices from people on the outside, because they've got their devices as soon as they leave our network anyway. So that was just an example of how, although it saved us like $200,000, which is a huge number.
Right.
And so do we see that on paper? Not really. But we were going to have to, you know, what does that mean? That means that we could spend more money on Chromebooks and infrastructure for our kids, which, you know, in the last few years, we have dramatically changed the technology in the schools. I mean, dramatically. In the last 2.5 years, we were way behind. Like, we were using books that I don't even want to talk about, and now we're at least at par, or some cases ahead of other districts in that area. Mostly we're ahead because we transferred very early to Google Chrome. Lots of districts are kind of coming up behind, but we can get three or four Chromebooks for the price of one Mac, and we did that early. And so that's the only reason we would be ahead in terms of our work.
So sort of a back and forth on that is interesting enough. So the group now learns from each other. So from our perspective, we're just, which is where you want to be, we're keeping them between the rails. And the great thing about IT people is they're idea people anyway. So the school's transition to Google helped the municipal IT folks think about whether or not that made sense for us. Less of a corporate solution than an education solution. But as our folks looked at it, they saw the benefit of going to Google in the long term from an apps perspective, moving away from Microsoft products, and being able to see it work in the schools, although not an exact, you know, match, allowed us to do the same. So we have now transitioned to a Google platform for Gmail, for sharing documents with the schools, the interactive agenda that you now see. So it's allowed for a little bit, this is a little bit of a unique situation in the sense that it's allowed for a little bit of an incubator process between the groups, which is really helpful. And yet, in some ways, if you looked at this, so if you looked at this organizationally, it looks like one organization. If you're inside the organization, it really is service provider, service deliverer. So it's a little bit of a different model. So it's a little different than some of the joint processes we've had, but I think to a certain extent probably represents the most successful model. We have a single, as you know, a single phone system. We have a fiber backbone that connects each and every municipal building, municipal school, water towers for communication, everything. That's unusual in this world to have a municipal government that have that much sort of bandwidth and continuity around its network. It makes it easier to adjust things and communicate, so which is helpful, and that led to things like a single phone system, something simple like being able to call between school and town facilities. So I think it's a really great example. And to the second point of this, that is not necessarily a dollar cost savings. That's about, you know, sort of the five tenets of dealing with what we do when you're dealing with, you know, people and what they're doing is, can we make them more efficient and more effective? And I think we are far more effective in this mode than we would be operating two separate IT shops.
You said there was a technical interface on the school side to talk to the municipal side, McClure?
Yes.
Who is that? And, or no, who is that working?
So my person is Mike Grant. He's the director of information technology for the schools. He's a part of my central office team. Mm-hmm. And he, in his short tenure, 2.5 year tenure, has really transformed technology in the schools. And any parent could comment on that. It's been quite remarkable. So Mike and Chris spend time together and work collaboratively with one another.
Do Chromebooks leave the school with the kid?
No, they do not, except for in one instance, which is another example of a partnership. We are actually putting 21 of the school's Chromebooks at the library, starting in a few days, actually, if they're not already there.
At the library?
At the Stevens Memorial Library.
Yes, okay.
Because we're partnering, and this is another example of a partnership, a recent one. Mm-hmm. We're partnering with them to do a Girls Who Code program, which is teaching girls 6th through 12th grade how to code, basically programming skills. And the library's hosting it, and we're providing the computers for it. So there'll be 21 school-issued Chromebooks at the library. And when they're not being used on Monday nights for Girls Who Code, they're going to be able to be checked out by our students or anybody else. But the good part for our students is when they go there, they'll be able to get right onto the school platform and their Google platform immediately. So it's another example of where we've partnered. So I can only talk about the most recent ones, which was our library. We have an embedded librarian where mm-hmm. we have a librarian who is at Atkinson halftime and at the Stevens Memorial halftime.
You're happy how that's working out?
It's working out great. We're very happy with that, I think. And, you know, our relationship with the library has really blossomed over the last little bit. We were talking about Jacqueline Woodson. Mm-hmm. And then the other one that is new, and I think you know that we was a little tricky, is already I'm extremely happy with our shared legal counsel. We hired very collaboratively, hired someone. I was involved in the hiring committee from beginning to end, and so was the school committee, and she has been an incredible asset and a savings to, I think, both of our organizations.
So that is really being used.
Yeah, she's fabulous.
It's as if we have had the position for a long time.
It's like she's always been here, and I think she's been here less than a month.
So a diverse set of issues that arise every day. You know, it's one of those things that Jen and I often talk about, is that issues arise every day that we wish we had another set of ears or another person. And that could be any particular discipline, but especially on the legal side. So often we're dealing with issues that we have to navigate legal channels, and it's not practical, either cost-effective or practical, unless you had direct connect to your legal counsel and constantly were dealing with us. Having someone in-house that you can, you know, knock on the door or make a phone call to and have him close, have him attend a meeting, that otherwise we would, you know, we deal with that level of issues. Sometimes they're personnel or people-related issues. Sometimes they're contract issues.
Information requests.
So being able to have that ready resource means that we're getting, on a cost-per-hour basis, a responsible legal perspective, which is one-third of what it would be otherwise.
And she has a deep background
in
municipal law.
Yeah, she has a lot of background. So it's great.
We both use outside counsel. So in the past, prior to Suzanne Egan coming on, so it's kind of the Venn diagram as we talked about it. So there's some things that we definitely share. I think the biggest number there is personnel, information requests, policies, that kind of stuff. And she's able to really do that work. Mm-hmm. She also has a specialty in land use, so that is helpful. But for instance, in issues of special education, that's not her expertise, so we still use outside counsel for that. But there, you know, we were very thoughtful when we planned this, understanding that we would both need to retain outside counsel for specialty areas. And even in some personnel issues that are, for instance, let me give you a really good example. Teacher contractual language and the rules and the arbitrations and the case law around teacher tenure is very specific. And so on a case that we've been dealing with, Suzanne actually sat with my outside counsel. Right. So which is wonderful. Right. But you're not going to navigate that for the first or second or third time alone, because that's a really tricky, specific law around that is not applicable to the municipal side.
So is the IT guy interacting with this legal counsel and compiling all the knowledge or information that she is imparting to us?
What do you mean? The IT person, you said?
Yes, because whatever knowledge that you're getting from the, or advice that you're getting from the legal person, if the IT guy takes that knowledge and compiles and build a knowledge base for you, it would be like a library for you.
So I wouldn't say that it's my IT person. I would say in most cases it's my human resources person who's compiling information.
So that can be accessed.
Yeah, absolutely. But it's much more on the human resources side than the IT.
So let's talk a little bit about that in terms of what it doesn't do. So in the short term, so I would say to you, just to answer your question from the town's perspective, in the 6 weeks that Suzanne Egan has been here, we've incurred no legal costs other than Suzanne's salary. No, $1 from outside legal.
I have.
And it, sometimes that's just, in fact, it's almost always timing.
It's timing, right? And special.
You don't know the matter that comes up. And I'm not saying that's going to be the future, quite frankly. It's probably not. But it has been, she has diverse enough experience, more than 20 years of experience on the municipal side, that the breadth of the issues to date have been in that lane. And I think that sometimes we're going to use specialized counsel, but to date hasn't happened. As it relates to institution, one of the things that bringing in counsel doesn't do, and something that we should all be cognizant of, is the fact that you lose the institutional knowledge has to be imparted by any number of folks, a lot of which have many years' experience in town hall and the school side, and so that Suzanne can catch up to speed on what we know about the specific institutional knowledge. So, for the last 5 years, I've negotiated most of the collective bargaining agreements, so I have to share that with her. What I haven't negotiated for the previous 10 years, the assistant town manager may have accomplished. Segueing to another piece of joint services, we've had shared procurement officer now for 10 years. It is seamless. The cost is, you know, some towns have a procurement officer on the town side and a procurement officer on the school side. We have one procurement officer, and then that's supported by Mr. Mealy, who does a lot of work on the school side. So all of us... it's incumbent upon all of us to share that institutional or the historical knowledge with her so that she doesn't have to reinvent the wheel on some of these topics, which has a tendency to happen if you don't do that. So I think that's going to take some time. That's the piece that we have to catch up on. But certainly to date, the resource has been fantastic. It's been great.
Now, I will say that there's one decision that we made last year that we have agreed that didn't make a ton of sense. And it's, you know, again, we're willing to try things, but we're also not willing to make it work if it's not working. And that was really around payroll. And the needs of school payroll are so far different than the needs of municipal payroll that we tried and we gave it a really good shot. And you will see in my budget presentation for next year that we are asking to, we're going to go back to a school payroll person. And it's something, you know, we spent a lot of hours on it, trying really hard to make it work and seeing what we needed to do. But in the end, it seemed like just the kind of the logistics of schools and the logistics of municipal payroll were such that trying to bridge those was not working. Yeah, I'm going to say that I think one of the trickiest parts is with teachers and teaching assistants. How do you get that information from the various schools to payroll in a very streamlined way? So a teacher is out or has a personal day or is, you know, that it comes from a school secretary into the central office and then gets sent to payroll, and that's very cumbersome. It's very different than a police officer who's doing overtime. It's the nature of schools are such that the person who's doing that data entry is not It's the school secretary who's also dealing with the kid throwing up on them and the parents coming in and out and all of those other things, that it's just a very different interaction. And so our data coming was not presented in the same manner, was not presented with the same level of fidelity, and then really trying to meet the needs of teachers and what they needed. On the backside was that we were very demanding in some respects compared to the municipal side, and in my opinion, appropriately demanding from the teachers, but it was just a different way of dealing, and kind of the nature of a school is very different than the nature of an office, and it became very hard to do that. I think that's my best way of summarizing it.
Yeah, I think the interaction with payroll and the municipal side is typically largely hands off. That it is, I think that's a good analogy, sort of office versus. Yeah, I wish I had another example for schools. It wouldn't be obvious.
Craziness.
And we have some of that on the police and fire because we have a lot of different, you know, police and fire don't just receive sort of a check out of one bucket. There's a lot of moving parts, and public works can be the same. But most of that is handled in a standard, sort of standardized way. So our routine around payroll is different than the schools, which is more interactive with the school administrators and down into the classroom. It's just different. So it's not that it's not possible. It just creates friction where one is unnecessary. And so from our perspective, we weren't paying a heck of a lot for payroll. This was an added efficiency to that. But it just didn't make sense because it was straining our ability to do other things because a person dealing with this sort of routine, I won't say mechanical, but more mechanical process is now dealing one with this highly interactive and having a person try to sort of flip their brain between standardized and routine and personalized is very, very difficult.
Just think of subs for a second. So we don't know who's coming in every day and we pay subs. Just even getting that information out of a school in an appropriate manner to the payroll is, and that changes every day and it's different people we're bringing on. I mean, trying to find substitutes for our school, I mean, it's really hard to find people who will come in and be a sub and to make sure that we're paying them. Those aren't people who sometimes they've been on payroll before, sometimes they haven't been on payroll before. It's that kind of complexity added a layer to the kind of the side. And yeah. And in the end, we felt like, you know, we had had one full-time on the school side and a half-time on the municipal side, and we needed one and
60.
Right, 60%. Yeah. We needed to go back to that same number, and it just made sense to have somebody embedded in the schools.
So you don't have people punching clocks in the schools?
No.
We don't punch clocks.
They don't punch clocks. Would firemen be punching clocks?
No, we don't have clocks.
Okay.
You don't need a clock. So if you're assigned as a firefighter and you're doing a 24-hour shift, you arrive at a certain time. If you don't arrive at that time, you're AWOL with your chief. So the clock days, generally speaking, there would be a little bit of a difference around public works. Would be a closest example we would have to clocks because we're dealing with things like, for instance, the snow response to a snow. Mm. When the person is called may or may not be relevant. It's when they check in that's relevant. So I think the closest we would get to sort of a traditional sort of clock environment would be that of public works.
An idea that it just seemed like it was so natural. We'll just combine these payrolls.
Yeah.
And, you know, the devil's always in the details.
Always in the details.
And most of them have worked. I mean, I think that's the thing that we want to be honest about is that we are going to give it the best shot. And if it works, great. And if it doesn't work, I mean, we're reflective enough to say, okay.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's important.
Well, part of it is the relationship, too, is that work and non-work is an interesting term, right? Can we make payroll work?
People have been paid.
Yes. So,
well, people,
so people were paid.
Fine,
so the question is, part of this, because we do manage through the relationship end of things, is you don't want one aspect of that group receiving service to feel like it's uncomfortable, it's not natural, it's not working. It's requiring an effort, a commitment of relationship, right? Because everything we do has a level of relationship committed to it, that it then somehow burns a bridge to the next project we try. And this is one it just didn't, in the end, didn't feel comfortable. It wasn't flowing. And I can say the same thing about IT, but we recognized that IT was IT, right? And this we saw as a back office process, and I think through the process we realized it was more than back office. There was a personal piece to this.
So we go through a process, and I have to commend everything you've done.
Hmm.
And I'm just, now we're picking on one particular area. We go through a process saying, how can we make it work? How can we standardize things? How can we make things more efficient? How can we eliminate a position so we can invest that position somewhere else? And
well,
yeah, I'm a little surprised.
I'll correct you on that. I'm not going to say that. I'm not saying we're eliminating positions to put them somewhere else.
Moving.
We're trying to create
a use of positions.
I appreciate that.
That's really what I'm making the back. That's the whole idea behind this conversation is getting the best investment in our resources. But I'm kind of a little surprised at the payroll because it seems like that's not this standardization that could happen there. It could make things happen. Hasn't quite been approached. It sounds like it's kind of haphazard,
so
back of the envelopes.
The reality of the situation, in my opinion, on the school
know.
Side,
yeah,
it would cost us more to standardize it on the school side than we would save. So let me give you a really clear example. We currently ask our school secretaries to do all of this. I would have to hire somebody to go to the schools in order to be able to standardize the whole process. When we ask our school secretaries to do this in between all of the issues that they're dealing with, we need to have some level of flexibility on the backside to deal with the fact that it's not completely standardized. It would cost us more to send somebody to each of those schools to get it standardized than it would cost us to have somebody here who is actually going to take a less than perfect output and create it.
So there's not a way
to save money in that way.
So there was an assumption, so let's get into the inputs and then because we talked about the outputs, right? So the inputs on this was that we were reducing the overall FTE count with an assumption that a person with experience on one side could assimilate to the other. One of the assumptions going in was that the school secretaries would take on more responsibility than they had before we made the transition because it was a position handling that conversation between the data. And so the assumption was, if the school secretaries work as that point of contact, that the group smoothing the data out to work in our sort of back office of payroll, then we could do it. And what we're finding is, by adding that on to this individual, and then removing a staff position, so assigning a portion of what was happening with that school staff position to the individual secretaries, we interpreted that as possible. And what we're finding is, yeah, it's possible, but it's impacting their ability to do other things. And so from our perspective, that's why it is payroll, everybody's getting paid, right? So the process is working, but the impact of making the process work is in the individual schools. And we're finding that we would rather have, I'm speaking for Jen, I don't mean to be, we'd rather have those individual staff members in those schools focusing on what they did before the payroll switch than sit there and be able to argue that it's a success for payroll because the payroll is working, because the impact of that successful payroll is happening at the schools, and we collectively think that that's not a good choice of a successful outcome.
And everybody who knows, especially in elementary school, knows that that school secretary is the key person to holding that place together.
Yep. Opportunity costs of their time.
Yes.
Is there a payroll company that does the processing of payroll? Or
no, it's all internal.
We do it all ourselves.
Yep, it's all internal.
I could probably move a little bit. You think there are any other initiatives that you consider in the near term, say in the next 24 to 36 months?
Well, I think it would be staff specific.
School, in terms of the school municipal shared services concept.
You know, I don't have one that's at the cutting edge of that. I think because we've explored, quite frankly, so many payroll facilities. We didn't talk about facilities, but that's joint. I think we could be better at it, but in the longer term. But that's one that we have in play. We have procurement in play, human resources in play. So I think we don't have one that I'm aware of sort of ready. We have the library piece, which Jen suggested. And it's been significant. So we don't have one ready, but that doesn't mean that they don't. They have a tendency to sort of come up from nowhere a little bit. We're very good at looking at what other districts and other municipalities do and borrowing or plagiarizing, if necessary, those things we see as successes.
With appropriate references.
Yeah, that's great. And so we'll continue to do that to try to find ways to make things work. I mean, again, I don't think more than 12 months ago we thought about the legal counsel piece, and today it's a reality. So they have the tendency to come up a little faster than we expect.
What about the TIPS
program? The TIP program?
Yeah.
To create substantially separate programs at the elementary level?
So we've done that, and so it's right over here at Kittredge, and it's allowed us to keep a number of students in district and bring a few back, and we feel very good about that. It's a program that we've staffed appropriately. So one of the challenges of these situations, and I'm just going to play this out, so out-of-district costs are a huge issue, as you all know very well on this committee. And one of the challenges is we want to talk about keeping kids in district. But when we keep kids in district, we need to do so with the appropriate staff. And so one of the things I worry that North Andover Public Schools has done in the past is try to create a program but not staff it at adequate levels, which then ultimately leads to us having the kid go out of district. And so one of the challenges is putting the right amount of investment in at the beginning, which may not be cost efficient right at the beginning, but ultimately will have impact. So the thing that we did last year at TIP was we gave them a full-time counselor. Prior to that, we were basically using the school guidance counselor in that role, and these are students who need significant emotional, social intervention on a daily basis. So we feel like we have been able to really staff that appropriately. And so far, we've been very pleased with that. We also were able to create some great space for the kids, because one of the other things is kids need space. If they aren't able to be in the classroom on a consistent basis, they need a place that feels like a classroom and looks like a classroom and acts like a classroom. And that program, we are pretty pleased with. The numbers, I think right now are like 12 or 13. I could be wrong. And that's not a huge number, but that's 12 or 13 kids we'd probably be sending out if they weren't there. And that's actually a big number in that regard. Mm-hmm. And the bottom line is we also made a pretty significant change in creating a behavior technician model, where we have kids who, mostly on the autism spectrum, who are included in classrooms with a BTA, which is a behavior technician aide, someone very well trained to support those kids. And the part that all of this is great, it's thoughtful financially, but it also is what's right for kids. And so kids should be included as much as possible in their schools. And so the best part of this is it's what's right to do morally, ethically, educationally, and ultimately if you do it right, it can actually rein in costs. And so that's why something like this whole initiative that we're going to continue to work on. We're also doing something. The other concern I've had about North Andover in terms of some of our the public school side is we have contracted out a lot of services for our students, especially our students on IEP. So let me give you a very specific example. We have spent almost $250,000 on home services. So we have contracted with numerous home service providers to go into the home and do training in the home. And so for a number of students with significant disabilities, they get home services part of their IEP, so that they need to, after school, they're in their home, they're teaching the parents, they're working with the kids. And that's, all districts deal with that. The challenge is when you contract those out, you're paying a premium for a lot of those. What we've done with our new behavior technician model is we have said, okay, behavior technicians, I was able to negotiate this with the union last year, you're going to make a little bit more per hour. And on top of that, you're going to be able to work beyond the hours, and you're going to do home services. So what was costing us $60 an hour on the contract side is costing us about $22 an hour on the home on our side. The best part, again, about that is the kid is getting that support from that person in school and then is getting the same support at home. So one of the challenges is when you have different providers at home and at school, you could be getting mixed messages about supports. So we're working really hard on that. We hired a district BCBA, which is a name for a behavior specialist, to oversee that program. Again, examples of where we might be able to be more efficient in our work. And it requires a little bit of a leap of faith, right? Because when you start it, you have to actually hire the people to build the model that you hope they will come. Do you see, you know, and so, and I would really say that, you know, Andrew's just been so supportive of these ideas. When I explain, like, hey, we could save this money, but it's going to cost us a little in the beginning, and, you know, and it's just wonderful. So there's examples of that. And then last year, I also hired an I heard two central office folks that I'm very much hoping will help our institution. One is an assistant superintendent of student services. So what we've done is this assistant superintendent of student services, the one who's doing the home model, right? So she's in charge of special ed, but also counseling. And to get somebody who can come in and kind of creatively problem solve these issues, we hired an assistant superintendent level person because it's a huge chunk of our budget. And I felt like they need to come in and really think creatively about that. And then the other thing that we did is hire a director of human resources to really do all aspects of human resources. Prior to that, we had a director of personnel who very much was kind of getting the paperwork done rather than really making sure, kind of seeing it as a proactive job. And so, you know, there's some things that we've done that at the beginning look like they could cost a little bit more money, but in the end are going to reap rewards as we're really making sure our staff feel supported. They understand FMLA. They understand what their sick days are. I mean, things that ultimately cost us if it's not done correctly. And then also in terms of bringing services inside, thinking creatively about services, and building programs that have us have kids stay in district. And then, frankly, we also brought a student. We're really getting to the point of bringing students from other districts into our district for special education services, right? Yep, and so again, bringing in the level of Dr. Donna Strait to do that with her track record of that. So again, it's one of these situations, and we're talking about personnel, where we kind of had to, and Andrew I know probably has a number of examples similar to that. Where
not
we
as
kind,
interesting.
Where we kind of had to invest a little to get a lot. Do you know what I mean? And I feel very confident. You know, you've worked with the human resources person, that just the level of professionalism and understanding of the complexities. I mean, as you know, human resources is our biggest allocation. So to have somebody in charge of human resources who understands the complexity of HR, HR law, HR support is really important.
You were working with a language related arts.
Yes.
The getting sixth and seventh graders exposed to world languages.
Yes.
Did that happen?
It did. It's very exciting. It did two things. One is that all sixth and seventh graders this year have a trimester of Spanish and a trimester of French, so they get exposure to each language. And when they have to make the choice in eighth grade, they aren't just doing it based on whatever. And then the other thing it did is we had something at what?
Nothing. Nothing. Was
yes.
Sure. It's good.
I was going to say my daughter told me if I can stop taking German.
So the problem is we tried to hire a French German teacher, but we couldn't find someone. So there's only about five of those certified in the state.
There's
we
plenty
did
of
try.
German at the high school.
And there's plenty of German at the high school. But there is German at the eighth grade level. So that did happen. And then the other thing that actually happened was that there was a thing at the middle school called grade level. So any parent might know a little bit about this, which was basically a study hall. I mean, I think there was other things that were happening, but it was really a study hall. And this actually allowed us to eliminate grade level completely. So it had numerous effects for a one FTE, which is like... So that did happen. And pretty much everything that I outlined in the budget last year did happen. And a few more things. So you saw in the budget presentation last year that we had put in some money on a contingency That was to make the assistant superintendent, and then also to support the hiring of a town council, because at this year, at our budget time last year, we weren't 100% sure we were going to go forward for that. And obviously, as at town meeting, we weren't sure that was going to go through either. So, you know, there were some other things that we said might happen and hoped that would, but weren't necessarily spelled out in the budget.
In terms of HR, you're talking about your new director of HR. What are we doing as a town to attract the best talent? So that, I think, is one of the most important things. Not only attract them, but keep them, because they're the people that are going to kind of continue to grow our schools and both, you know, in your side as well.
Yeah,
that's a great question.
So let me first say the one thing that's probably not widely known, and one of these shared services pieces that's never identified, is the town municipal government HR department does benefits for all employees, school and town. So it's although we think over time, the goal over time is to share that as the school's HR person comes on board and quite frankly has the skill set to do that.
Yes.
At this point, if you're a retiree, you're a teacher, you're a retired teacher, you're a municipal employee, active or retired, you get your benefits through our two-person HR department. So all nearly 600 employees, in addition to dealing with our hiring process and other related and all the FMLA rules and Small Necessities Leave Act and everything else, FLSA and the changes to FLSA and all that kind of stuff, the benefits coordination comes through our HR department in town hall. So it's important to understand.
And we're going to take on some of that, yeah, and support that.
So all that is linked in that way, and I think it's, and they've been very productive on that. There's a couple of things. Obviously, there's an expectation in any hiring process or in any employer that you need to pay a reasonable wage. That's first and foremost. Now, everybody can get into a subjective discussion of what a reasonable wage is, and we try to do a good job of understanding the market well enough to do that. We recently completed a salary study, I think it was last year, to evaluate our exempt staff and compare that exempt staff to a cohort of about 8 communities which actually used us in a similar study some years earlier, and then used that cohort study to make sure that we were in the range. Our goal is not necessarily to be at the maximum or the minimum, it's somewhere in between. And so we looked at our 60-plus exempt employees and evaluated those back against the cohort study done by another community in which we were a member to, and evaluated to make sure that we were in that range. We identified 4 to 6 positions, it might have been, I believe it was 6 positions out of that 60, who were below the range and have worked on a multiple-year plan which brings them into the range. Again, not trying to be necessarily at the top of the range, just competitive with our cohort so that we can make sure that an employee is a good employee, doesn't look at one of those neighboring or other communities and say, geez, why don't I go work there? We think the same on benefits. Most municipal governments offer just about the same benefits, so there's not a lot of differentiation as there would be in my experience with the private sector. But I do think the GIC product, not initially, but over time, has become the preferred product. So years ago, you went to the employer that had Blue Cross Blue Shield, because everybody had Blue Cross Blue Shield, and that was just what it is. Right, I'm aging myself, but we all were looking for Master Medical. That was the term, right? Today, it's not quite that way, because most plans are high-deductible plans. Mm-hmm. So even if you go to a municipality that has continued to use Blue Cross, the deductibles are fairly significant. And now if you go to a GIC community, you have a choice between multiple plans. You have HMO plans, you have POS plans, you have PPO plans. You should choose the nature of the plan that meets your lifestyle. Do you care about Boston Hospitals, not care about Boston Hospitals? So I think what's changed in the industry, and it's good for us, by being a participant in the GIC, we're offering our employees choices about health care, where in some communities they may have assumed they were in the best product, but that product has now started to evolve to be more complicated. And next, we have personnel policy, which governs our exempt employees and other staff, provides enough flexibility for me as the hiring authority to make discretionary decisions on things like, for example, vacation or longevity. It doesn't make sense in the good old days, and actually not so long, I think when I arrived, that personnel policy said, if you came to the town of North Andover, even if you had spent 20 years in the town of the city of Haverhill or the town of Andover, then you got 2 weeks vacation. Well, that doesn't make a heck of a lot of sense when you're trying to employ someone who had 4 weeks vacation in another community and says, yeah, your salary is competitive, but it's going to be 20 years before I get those 4 weeks. So we make sure that there's enough flexibility within our personnel policy to allow for an incentive that at least we're competitive in those cases. And then the balance for us, other than those 60 employees, we have 140 employees, and Jen has nearly twice that number, that are union. And so most of those are around bargaining and how we compare from a bargaining perspective to other communities. Like most private sector employees, we find that work environment is the driving reason why people stay. I think that Jen probably, her experiences are the same. We feel like we're a good environment, and we constantly try to work with our employees to have them tell us when things are not quite what they seem. It doesn't mean everything's perfect in every day. We have tried to look at some creative ways, but continue to struggle around the ideas of flex schedule. When you're a fixed town hall hours, it's pretty hard to contemplate someone coming in at 6 and leaving at, you know, noon, as an example, and have something else work past that. But we have, on fairly frequent occasions when people have alternative work schedule needs, working with those needs to make sure they get through things like child care and the related items. So we try to work through that as best we can.
No. All of what he said, and I would say that teacher salaries in North Andover are right in the middle also. And I think that this town has made the decision for many years to continue to pay the teachers, to teachers, you know, within the middle, nothing, not above, not below, even when our per pupil expenditure is lower than most of our surrounding communities. We've made the decision, and it was a smart decision, because if we're, you know, the one thing that the research shows, the one thing, other things are important, but the one thing that the research shows it's most important for achievement of kids is quality of teacher. And so, you know, we need to make sure that we are able to attract good quality teachers, and we have to be competitive with other districts if we're going to do that. A few other things I would add. Everything Andrew said, I would add a few other things. You know, one of the things, and this might be a school kind of warm and fuzzy feeling, is you just got to take care of your people too, right? And so, you know, for instance, we have an employee assistance program. When someone's struggling, we've brought them in and to support, you know, our I think they would be okay with me sharing this. Our ECC, our Early Childhood Center, has kind of had a cloud over them in terms of just things happening personally for all the people who work there. So we have brought somebody in on pretty much a weekly basis just to support them. And it's not like it's any one thing. It's just it's kind of been a people who are working there are struggling with a lot of personal issues. Mm-hmm. Across. And so it was to a point where we were like, help, and we brought someone in, right, and we had them come in, and we showed that we cared, and I showed up, and the HR person showed up, and the counselor showed up. And so I think you have to take care of your people too, and you know, having a human resources person who understands that their job is taking care of their people too. And again, I mean, you know, if we're going to ask our teachers to take care of our kids, we have to take care of our teachers, right?
I would say that as it relates to that, one of the things that we find as employers, and I think for those of you who are employers, it's consistency in terms of dealing with human resource issues. It's one of the things that I find most important. One of the things that creates most anxiety in a work environment is to find out one employee is treated in one way and another employee is treated another way. And so that the consistency is relevant. Every circumstance can be different. We're dealing with people, so we, you know, people come to work with the issues they bring to work, and that's okay. But developing a level of consistency to make sure that the chatter within the work environment is such that people recognize that there's some kind of consistency to how we approach issues on a regular basis. We certainly have an EAP program as well. Work regularly with employees to find assistance when necessary, and so I think all those things are in play when we're dealing, you know, we're dealing with people.
And the only thing there I would add is one of the things that we did last year in the schools is pretty radically change our hiring practices. So let me just give you a very quick, you'll understand, example. So I'm a leadership is often tight and loose. There's things that you're loose about that you kind of let things happen, and then there's things that you kind of are tight. This is how we're going to do it. Interestingly enough, hiring practices, I'm tight. And so I pretty much made an edict, probably my only major edict last year, that anyone who is hired within the North Andover Public Schools under my tenure has to do a demo lesson or equivalent. I don't understand when teachers come into a room like this, interview with a bunch of adults, and they get hired to interact with kids all day. I just don't see that that's a good way. So what we've done is they come in and meet with a bunch of adults, if that's the first round. Second round is they go in front of a bunch of kids and teach a lesson, because that's actually what we're hiring them to do. And then we decide who is the best fit for the North Andover Public Schools, not necessarily based on, I mean, interacting with adults is important, but how do they do with the kids? That seems so simple. But the reality is a lot of districts, I mean, I got hired to teach, and I never taught I never showed them I could teach, right? And so it's that kind of stuff that's really important. And then we did something else this year. So, again, teaching is a little tricky in that when you get hired for the first day of your fourth year, you have something called professional teacher status, which is a bit more protection. And I found here in North Andover, when I said, okay, so who's up for professional teacher status a year ago? People were like, not sure, right? You know, because it was just, okay, they're back for their fourth year. So this year, we were very intentional. If you hire somebody for your fourth year, my previous boss used to say it's $1 million investment. You're making $1 million investment in that person that you want them. So we were very intentional. A few people didn't make that fourth year. And we were very intentional. When you hire, you have to do that. It's an active decision, not a passive decision, to hire for the fourth year. And then what we did in, I think, October or November, is we actually had a professional teacher status ceremony where everybody was invited who got professional teacher status. Their parents were invited. Their spouses were invited. Their kids were invited. We had a master teacher, a Hall of Fame teacher, come back and speak. And then we honored each of them to say, welcome to professional teacher status in North Andover, which had the ability to say, like, this is an important moment. We value you. We have decided to make the $1 million investment in you. And so although that doesn't cost anything and that doesn't really, but it's a symbolic component of it means something to be an employee here in North Andover, very symbolically. And, you know, that event was very well received. And the corollary is every principal got up there and spoke about the person that they had recommended for teacher status. And they know that everyone they recommend for teacher status, they have to get up in front of their colleagues and say yes. Right? And these things, although, again, not huge and totally makes sense, you'd say, why wouldn't you do anything else, are changes in practice.
Okay. Have you looked at what are we lacking that our ranking is still very low?
Yes.
What ranking is that?
I don't want to. Okay. I think we should pull back a little bit and stay kind of focused on the topic, because we'll have plenty of time on that.
And ranking's tricky.
The ranking's, right. Yes. It's just a corollary, though, on the just so you know, just for more of the public, I guess, in the group, 1/3 of our staff is civil service. So Massachusetts was the first civil service state passed in the late 1800s, still exists. 1/3 of our staff are public safety folks, are hired off an exam and a test and a list. And are not, other than excluding someone from being considered, which is extraordinarily difficult to do, the only comparison we have to teacher status or tenure, as an old-timer would say, right, it's probably not the appropriate term today, is that folks serve in a year under a probationary status as a police and firefighter. After that year period, any action against that employee falls under civil service and certain rules of arbitration. So. In those cases, it really can be a little bit of a challenge. And the chiefs have been good about being more aggressive as the employee comes in the door as best they can within the confines of what civil service provides. Because more often than not, you really have to go test first. And so we've incorporated assessment centers for upper level ranks, which allow for...
Which are so cool.
Which are really cool. They're sort of fun to watch. It allows for sort of real life testing. Inbox exercises, the ability to have people put in circumstances that they may or may not be comfortable in as typical public safety officers. And we've done that at the superior ranks for the purpose of trying to vet out or glean from people who are at least getting beyond the patrolman or firefighter ranks whether or not they possess the skills to be in management. Most people who get into the public safety ranks do not become a police officer or firefighter to become a police lieutenant or a fire deputy chief or fire chief or police chief. They get into fight a fire to help people. And in the end, all those people will eventually become the leaders of the respective departments, and they deliver a very important service. So by instituting assessment centers, which are independent folks who come in and evaluate these candidates, we're at least making more certain that these folks are ready for leadership.
And so would you say, I guess this is kind of focusing on question three, it seems like both of you have a pretty enough power to make the administrative changes that you need in terms of how your departments are structured by and large. Is that an accurate statement that you're able to say, hey, this position that we had this year didn't make sense. I'm going to reorganize my organization and do things a little bit differently next year. In general, even given the fact that you're dealing with unions in a lot of cases.
Yeah, and I mean, yes, and, you know, for me, and I think it's the same for you, I mean, I can make a recommendation to the school committee, but the school committee has to approve that change.
Right.
So, you know, again, we recommend, I think, in both of our cases, our committees trust that we're doing it thoughtfully, but ultimately, The decision to, for instance, take the director of special ed and make it an assistant superintendent had to be approved by the school committee.
Moving along, I put this on there, and I know it's a very controversial subject, but we talked a little bit about outsourcing because, you know, at the end of the day, there are certain core services that are provided in any organization that completely cannot be outsourced, like teaching or
Jen and I
fighting fire. Yes, but then there are others that are able, and I know the law is a little tricky, and no one's saying that it's a good idea. Yeah. But you know, eventually, every dollar that we spend has to be kind of examined, and I think that's going to be one of the realities of, you know, the evolving public policy is, you know, how can the cities and towns have the flexibility to provide the core services and then right. maybe reduce some expenses in other areas.
So let's talk about outsourcing. So it's helpful because I think the public sometimes doesn't always realize how much we outsource. I recently got a call from another community, which I will not mention, but just doesn't have North in front of its name, where their residents were claiming we outsource more than them, and they were pushing their administration to looking more outsourcing. So I think we do a pretty good job at this, and we'll always reflect on it. So let's talk about those things that we do outsource. Trash, commonly a public service 20 years ago, is an outsourced contract service. Street line painting, as an example, another contracted outside service. Some communities actually do that in-house. Paving is done as an outsourced delivery of a product. Not all, but some extensive water main replacement or installation. We don't do that with internal staff, although emergency repairs we naturally would. If we have plumbing, electrical, elevator-related maintenance and facility issues, all done by existing contract. Same thing with HVAC. We don't maintain existing staff. There are towns that do. Craftsman work of a carpenter that happen in a building to make improvements, we outsource that work as well. 60% of our snow operation is outsourced. Cleaning in some of our buildings, but not all of it, and it's a pretty good example we can sort of peel off and show you. But cleaning is an example, and some of our buildings is done by contract, and some buildings not, depending on the nature of the work, because we have a combination of custodians and cleaners. The maintenance of our streetlights is a contracted work with a company that does specializes in that. Traffic signals, that's done through a contract maintenance as opposed to us performing that work. So
pest management.
Pest control, always another great, exciting topic to talk about, right?
Transportation on the school side is a huge number.
Yep. And you have some school lunch stuff as well.
Yeah.
So it's always an interesting study around the idea of outsourcing and insourcing. And I think we certainly we take the more obvious ones that municipalities have outsourced, and we do those. And then we have some other ones beyond the traditional. Some people do maintain full facility staff with a certified electrician, a licensed electrician, a licensed plumber on staff to deal with issues. We don't. We contract those kind of things out. One of the challenges typically for us, we evaluate almost every service in this context. So we have and will continue to look at ways to outsource. For us, it becomes some standard sort of framework that helps us understand if it's possible. So if it is a routine job, labor intensive, but not requiring specialization, it automatically fits into a conversation. So trash would be an example. If you add on to that even if the equipment is not sophisticated but is expensive, trash trucks are very expensive, and there's a high maintenance component with it, then we often will outsource. So again, trash being a really good example. Every trash truck costs north of $300,000. If you're going to put two trucks on every route every day, if you've got two, you need a backup, you have to maintain those, you have to fuel them, and all the like. Your workers' comp is going to go up, your insurance is going to go up. So trash became for almost every community sort of a standard bearer for how you do those things. Cleaning is another common one, but actually in some ways much more difficult to analyze. So let me give you a good example. We pay $27,000 for cleaning of senior center, town hall, and what was community development. So that is a cleaning company. They come in, they clean the bathrooms, they empty the trash, they do what we would define as cleaning.
When do they do this?
At nighttime.
At night.
Yeah, because daytime doesn't make a lot of sense, obviously.
I'm thinking about applications of other, you know, in the school department, for instance.
Right. It's really tricky to have outsources custodians during the day.
Yeah, so it's mostly nighttime. But you guys
do
it in a different way.
Can they work at night?
Who are we talking about?
Custodians in schools?
They do. Some of our custodians.
They do.
Yeah.
And we have some weekend work. Library is a little trickier for us because of the number of hours it's open and making sure someone's there for the weekends. So what we're balancing is the ability to make sure we can respond to a problem. So that sort of funny differentiation between cleaning and custodial services, right? What does a custodian do versus a cleaning company? We found if we can isolate cleaning, right, trash, cleaning the bathrooms from the custodial work, and allow the custodians to do things like, for instance, the custodian at Town Hall will handle Town Hall and Senior Center for snow removal. So if it snows, the person who's on the curb when the building needs to be open, it's not public works, they're in the roadways dealing snow with in a traditional way. Your custodians do the same for these buildings.
Right.
So custodial work can be different from cleaning, but an interesting example with the cleaning was we had contracts for cleaning for those three facilities I mentioned and totaled about $28,000 a year. So cleaning floors, mopping floors, cleaning bathrooms, you know, traditional stuff. Stuff you would think you could outsource. So one problem we found was, to a certain extent, was that Town Hall is a now far more widely used in the last 6 or 7 years than it was previously. We have meetings regularly there in the evening. There is no staff to close and lock the building. So we've got a building, I'm not advertising this to the public, but we have a fairly expensive asset now with a lot of really interesting stuff in it, with a lot of technology and related stuff. And what we relied on was the last person out of the building to shut off the lights. It's not consistent with a professional setting, nor is it make me or anybody else particularly comfortable. So we evaluated our contracts for cleaning versus the possibility of bringing a staff member on at a 0.4 or 0.5 FTE, below the benefit standard, and what that cost would be in comparison. And what we found was that if we eliminated the cleaning for Town Hall and community development at a cost of about $17,000-$18,000, we could bring in a half FTE person at about $15,000-$15,500. Get the benefit of having someone in the building during meetings, because you're concerned about someone wandering around that building, leaving a meeting, and no one else in the building, or someone getting trapped in the building. So we now get the benefit of sort of supervision or someone in the building till 10 o'clock. We're bringing in the service to have someone do the cleaning. We're not paying the traditional benefits we would, and it costs us about $3,000 less than the cleaning contract. But we didn't do the same as it relates to the senior center, because when you evaluated that in the context of the cost benefit, it didn't work. So all of this stuff is cost benefit. If there's a particular specialization, then we may not hire the staff that specialize. So a lot of our engineering work, for instance, is outsourced. We spend well into the six figures for engineering work. So we have an in-house engineer and an assistant in-house engineer. They're very skilled. But if they spent forever developing plans and went through that process, we wouldn't get a lot of projects done. So we often hire engineering services outside because the firms bring to bear the proper resources to make sure projects get on time. So we do a fair amount outsource, but it's always a function of evaluating each particular service and determining whether or not there's a benefit, something subtle like having someone in the building, and whether or not it's just in the long term it's beneficial to us to have it pay for the service rather than hire an employee.
And the one we haven't talked about in schools that a lot of schools do is their cafeteria or their food. Our cafeteria continues to operate in a surplus, and so not a big surplus, but it's not in the red.
Right.
And so for us, it's...
And it's a revolving fund.
Yeah,
too, right?
And it's revolving. So as long as we're operating in the black, it seems crazy to outsource something that is actually generating profit for the schools. And now other districts, I will tell you, they outsourced in my previous district the food because
most
it was not it was not operating in the black. It was operating in the red.
Right.
I will tell you that on a school setting, just having lived through, for instance, the cafeteria outsourcing, it was hard on the schools.
Right.
You know, some of the kind of core people who work in your schools are the people who run the cafeterias, and they know the kids, and they are kind of part of the fabric of the school. And when that gets outsourced, you have a higher turnover, the folks who are coming in, and there just isn't that kind of knit, that close-knit community. And so even though the bottom line might have been better for my previous district, I think the kind of impact on the kids was felt when it was, you know, it wasn't the person who had been the cafeteria, I'm going to be a little stereotypical here, lady for many years who everybody knew. And I think you'll lose something in that. But given that ours is operating in a positive cash flow, it would be silly to lose that for...
Right.
So what's interesting, as you kind of have walked through these, Mr. Miller, is this is sort of where you see a lot of industries doing this, which is looking at and saying, what's the highest skill level that we can employ that's going to be somebody that is part of our community, and take those other functions as the ability to really specialize. The level of specialization that companies offer now, I mean, that's one of the amazing things about our economy, is that you can create a business that does just controlling lights or painting streets. There are so many specialization opportunities. And one of the things that is fascinating to hear is how you've identified those, because there are things that I don't think off the top of our heads we would know about or the community would know about. And so it kind of brings us to that point of what's sort of the thought process of your peers and sort of the industry right now? I know in my industry there's a lot of looking at outsourcing and maybe starting to bring it back in because, well, there are some efficiencies. The true control factor is getting more important. So having consistency and very high performance, low error, is now overriding some of the efficiency considerations. So are there any trends sort of in the industry, so to speak, that you're talking about that may shape this a little bit?
Yeah, I'm not sure I see necessarily a direct trend. I would tell you that what's happened in most communities, most communities suffered through the, 08 and 09. I think that's pretty consistent. But for most communities that are, for a community like North Andover that's always balancing those things, right, we're never quite in the clearing, right? Mm-hmm. We're constantly chasing that. And that's okay place to be. I find the good news is that Jen and I and our predecessors and your predecessors regularly thought about these questions. And so it's a regular challenge for us. And I think that that's a good thing. There are most of the places that have, for instance, full-time traffic signal operators who also might be licensed electrician and do electrical work, something that we wouldn't carry, that we couldn't carry as overhead. Some of those communities haven't changed away from that because they can afford it. And so I find, like everything else, what's the expression? What's the motherhood of invention? Necessity, right? Yeah. It's a little bit like that. We're constantly challenged a little bit, showing the forecast last night. How do we close the gap from what I show to what we're going to be? Mm-hmm. I think to a certain extent that is a motivational factor for most communities that are in sort of our mm-hmm. our swath, to make sure that we're constantly looking at different ways to do things. Certain things, if you get to the point that you can't provide the basic service, that's different. Then all of a sudden we're in a different dialogue. So I'm not sure I've seen a specific trend. I would say that the difficult times of 08 and 09 led more folks to think of things and stop arguing that everything was essential, right? We did change that dialogue, at least for a brief period of time. It used to be that outsourcing or collaboration with other cities and towns meant we bought paper collaboratively. Right. That was like the big success. and I get a kick of it. It really was. Every time we collaborate with 10 other communities to buy bulk paper. And I was like, when I first came into the industry 25 years ago, that was like a big success. And I've never forgotten the fact that that was the success. And so what 08 and 09 really did for a lot of communities is we stopped talking about the paper, right? It wasn't really as essential as and maybe rock salt, which was another one. Road salt was another common collaborative. We've been doing that for a decade. We started to talk about more meaningful items. Can we outsource things or get creative? And I think we're effective in that regard. It's not just necessarily the specialization, unless you include, for an example, the ability for someone to walk into town hall and know that the person behind the counter may be a fellow resident or someone who sat there and experienced what they've experienced. So the fact that we have folks behind counters, right, we don't want to be all computers and ATM, the service version of an ATM. We want people to be able to make that personal contact about what's happening in terms of service delivery. So it's a really interesting niche, somewhere between that personal contact when you walk in town hall and that sort of skilled, specialized position mm-hmm. to determine what fits in the middle to make sure that we outsource those things so we can continue to afford the people who deliver the service on the ground. Like, that's an interesting balance. So we have an interesting one where we have a company that does the painting of certain ball fields before ball games. Because doing that, we had a staff member forever who did that. That's what that person did. And it made sense with that person. It's what they enjoy doing. But when that person left employ, it didn't make sense that that was a logical service. So we're able to free up a staff member because it's not a particularly expensive service to employ. So sometimes it seems like almost silly items in that regard, but it's looking at every possibility and be willing, as we've done, I think, with the consolidation. If it makes some sense and it saves $5, or it makes some sense it doesn't save anything but it makes us more efficient, we go ahead and do it anyway.
I would say the probably the biggest issue in our side is I think many districts chose to outsource their special education services 20, 30 years ago, right? So we have one kid who's on the autism spectrum. They put them in a special school that actually maybe saves some money. But what we've seen is that that's not the case. I mean, it's not the transportation costs coupled with the tuition cost, and in many cases it's not the right educational model. So I would say that the trend in school districts is trying to bring those services back as much as possible. A, because, you know, it, just even to say students on the autism spectrum, the population is much bigger now than it was, so that we can actually create cohorts of kids, mm-hmm. which is really important. If you have one student, that's hard to create a cohort, but you have five or six, you could have a cohort. So I would say that most districts are trying pretty hard to keep kids in district. For philosophical, educational, and financial reasons. So I think that's the one, and I know that that sounds crazy that we're outsourcing our education for some of our students, but that's really what the model was 20 years ago, was we are gonna put these kids in a, and you know, in some cases, you know, I use the example of like our incredibly medically fragile kids. We can't support them within a school. They need to be in a medically, you know, well-constructed place. So there are some kids for whom that is what they need, and obviously that's what we're going to give them because that's what we are committed to. And some other cases, but as most as possible, we're trying to bring those back into the schools. That would be kind of our corollary.
Okay. So if you just wrap this up, close the loop and sort of wrap up to something that hasn't been discussed, but it's important to understand that there's a little separate from, certainly separate from what Jenna identified. When we contract a service, and this goes into our sort of our inputs to deciding what we're going to do, we're subject in most cases, not in services like Jen identified, but trades especially, to follow the state's prevailing wage law. It is one of the things that this town has been remarkably outspoken about with its legislative delegation and others, but will likely never change. So when we go out and decide that we're going to hire someone to be an electrician, to perform electrical services when we have those issues, the state tells us what the prevailing wage is for the region, what we must pay the contractor we hire. So one of the real challenges around the idea of, there was a really interesting piece a couple of years ago about a town in Georgia that originally had a couple hundred staff and was down to seven. They outsourced everything but the seven. Good news was the town manager was one of the seven. And I think the DPW director and maybe the police chief and it was a series of others. But it was down to seven staff, and it was a pretty interesting piece about how they had done that. What I would say is I'm not saying I'm going there, but it was interesting, right, and certainly worth the academic challenge of thinking it through. But Georgia is not a prevailing wage state. You couldn't afford to outsource some of the items that we think about because the cost of the prevailing wage is intended to do exactly that. It's intended to contemplate the union wage for that particular trade, including benefits. Mm-hmm. Right. And in some cases, we are able to hire that person under our own benefit structure and our own union structure at less than what the prevailing wage says that is going to pay. So every time we evaluate a service, we must, in terms of contractual service, we must determine whether or not it's subject to the prevailing wage. Most times it is. And then determine if that prevailing wage is going to drive the cost of having that service provided by a contractor above the cost that we can provide it. We just have to be intellectually honest that we're going to include things like retirement when maybe it isn't easy to see on the page. But if we do that, it is one of the things that mitigates, to your question, Mr. Nobley, that mitigates this sort of maybe even more creative thinking about how ways we can do things better, because we bump up against some statutory provisions that some states, quite frankly, don't face, and certainly the private sector doesn't face.
Great. Yeah. Thank you.
I think we should shoot to be done at like 8:15 for you guys, because you have lives and should get home. But I thought one of the things I was thinking about, and Mr. Miller and I had a discussion a little earlier about sort of the trade-off between part-time in full time. And as we think about a lot of our OPEB liabilities and how they're increasing over time, and just, you know, if, as you talk about the $1 million decision, sometimes those $1 million decisions come up just because you, a position is full time versus part time. So how is the town sort of evaluating that, you know, sort of way of controlling expenses, future expenses?
Yeah, so we first have to start that the organization, that most municipalities by style, there's not a tremendous amount of redundancy in positions.
Right.
To a certain extent, that redundancy becomes less as you move up. So we're not, you know, 10 people deep in an organization, right? It's not manager, right? It's typically three in the deepest part and one in some cases. Mm-hmm. And I say that because one of the things that we need to do, and I think we've been effective with it, is that although administrative staff work in particular departments, there are not necessarily specific job descriptions between those departments. So melding a few of your questions together, one that's on here but not identified yet, the infamous collapse of 2018, I guess, or whenever that happens, is one of the strengths is being able to recognize a somewhat amorphous job description, one that says that a person's skills in one shop can be worked in another department. We don't practice that, but we're capable of doing it, okay? And so in that part, that sort of addresses that. But most what we do beyond that, because we only have one person, so we have one planner, okay, using that as an example. We have one building inspector. We have one of many things, one purchasing person, one accountant, one, and so we're not big enough to have the kind of redundancy that sometimes affords flexible work schedules or the opportunity to provide sort of multiple people. The idea of job sharing certain roles we have would be difficult to fathom compared to what it would be in, for instance, a private sector. So if you're outward facing to the public, the idea that one person, hypothesize, Angela will appreciate this one. Imagine if we had two part-time clerks. Like, how do we pull off an election where are you assigned that day to be the clerk on election, or is it your day off? And so I think in some cases, because of that sort of lack of, not lack of depth, but just the nature of our organizations, right, very much flat with not a lot of depth below it, right, then it really becomes narrow decisions we're talking about. And I think in cases we've had opportunities to do that, we evaluate. So the custodian was an example of part-time staff versus contract. We've had cases within the administrative staff, actually, I think Angela participated in, when Angela moved over to work to the clerk's office, we recognized an opportunity to take one of those staff members, the position left behind, and reduce that to part-time as an example. And so we do that as positions open, which I think is another question in here. Every time a position's open, we look at the job description to see if it's current to what we expect. That should be an expectation of every employer. We look at the job description. We do look at the market to see if it's union, it's a little different, but if it's a non-union positions, we look at the market to see what will yield when we go into the market to make sure that we're competitive, and sometimes that means salary adjustment, sometimes not. And then we do look at opportunities to see if we can reduce that positions. We did it with an accounting position in the last couple of years. One of the clerical positions, we brought those positions down. The payroll position was at one time full-time, brought down briefly for a period of time. So we do evaluate the options to reduce the amount of hours that someone works. And the library, I think, is the most classic example. The majority of the library employees work part-time. They are not full-time employees. Now, that allows the flexibility of working more hours, where we work a traditional 37.5-hour work week. When you're operating almost 60 hours, the amount of full-time staff you would need to do that compared to having the same number of bodies but half the FTEs by working people part-time gives them the ability to overlap shifts to work longer. So there are certainly options that we do look at to do that. And in the end, the question about what you do in that sort of catastrophic circumstances, you end up having to prioritize service delivery and start to make adjustments based on that.
I think in the schools, there's kind of two parts. So actually, last year, I eliminated job shares at the elementary level. I felt that it really was not consistent for kids to have one teacher in the morning, one teacher in the afternoon. We had that situation over at a kindergarten at Kittredge, and the kids had one teacher on Mondays and Tuesdays and half a Wednesdays, and another teacher half a Wednesday, Thursdays, and Fridays. And educationally, that just did not make sense to me, that consistency. However, there's lots of other places, so we went away from that in that case. But there's lots of tons of examples in the school where we use part-time folks. And that is often kind of in the ancillary services, not the kind of core classroom teachers. Right. It's the tutors. It's the reading specialists. I mean, we are like magicians at, you know, figuring out this many hours. I mean, Gilly is like, he's got every hour and what it costs, and can he get 16 hours of a tutor or 15 hours of a tutor or 13.257 hours of a tutor. So in those services, we can be, the challenge with that is, so let me just give you a really recent example. We had, our ELL population is something we really are thinking hard about how to support here in North Andover, and we had a tutor who was working at the Sargent, and we were paying them, you know, whatever, I think it was 12, 13 hours a week to come in and work with our kids. Just got scooped up by Burlington a few days ago for a full-time position. So one of the challenges of that in our market, especially around those specialized abilities, is if you don't have somebody full-time, you're at risk of losing them. Now, in some cases, it's wonderful. We just hired a reading specialist who is a mom with young kids and doesn't want a full-time job, so we're able to make that happen, but it gets really tricky when you rely on that. Do you know what I mean? So absolutely. We work really hard. I don't think high school's a little different because they can teach classes and it doesn't have to be a full 1.0, but it's really hard K-8 to have kind of the core classroom teacher right. not be full-time. I think that lack of consistency for kids is a problem. On the other services, we can be much more flexible. Speech and language, coming in and supporting kids, and we are, yes. But the balancing act is, are we going to lose people because we can't employ them full-time, especially around some of the specialists, because a lot of the people who are not the core classroom are people who are really hard to find.
Right.
I think the one thing we could do, the overall conversation, just sort of reflecting out loud, what we could be better at, and I think that really having sort of this two-headed benefit of human resources is that we need to ask the question every time to your original question. Every time we make a personnel decision, we have to ask if it's changing the financial impact on health insurance and retirement. I think we do that pretty well now, and I think that's evolved in all municipalities where no one ever paid attention to it. It wasn't a direct charge, right? Mm-hmm. We added someone to health insurance. It's over here somewhere. It's in a different line item. We don't do cost centers in the truest sense. We throw health insurance as a separate fixed cost, and we don't always think about health insurance in the context of a cost as relates to a cost center. I mean, I think we'll get better at that. We need to ask that question, both schools and municipalities, every time a decision is made. Is the decision we're making that may benefit from a service perspective have a cost that we're not currently attributing? Because that cost has tails, and the tails are OPEB, right? Right. And so it's one of those things that we, on the school teacher side, quite frankly, on the retired teacher side is now on the town side, so it has more of an impact, not on the active teachers, but when those people become retirees, it does.
Right.
Yeah. So we have to make sure that we talk about joint discussions, make sure that all of those discussions come in the context of understanding the true cost. Right.
So, Mr. Fernandez, let me ask you, as you described that, and thinking about your five-year plan, do you have sort of an overlay to that, looking at the projected retirements and how that feeds into it? I'm just kind of curious.
Feeds into
what
it
that
from
would
which
like.
Perspective? So, I would say a common phrase around town hall is succession planning. So we regularly think about what's next. If you mean specifically from an OPEB perspective, then OPEB contemplates through its actuarial study the assumption of retirements. So the question is, do we change the not change the assumptions? Can we alter the result of the assumptions? But the assumptions are baked in.
Right.
So the assumption that people are going to retire at a certain day, that's part of what's changing OPEB, is people work longer. So I used to remember these numbers, and now forget these numbers. But the standard practice was that if you worked 35 years and got to 55, you retired as a police officer. Police officers don't retire at 55 any longer. Firefighters were similar. We never had municipal employees work beyond 65. We had multiple 65-plus employees, some 70-plus employees. And all of that starts to get baked in. So what's changing really is the landscape of employee relations in terms of length of service and in terms of of its impact on things such as OPEB. That's what's changing to a certain extent. But actuarial studies are done under the law now on an every other year basis to make sure that those assumptions from an actuarial basis are baked into the process. So it's not the retirements that necessarily generate that, because that's assumed. Right. It's a function of maintaining, in my opinion, one of the things that gets under-discussed is if we continue to focus on maintaining health care costs more from an increased perspective, making sure that the premium costs stay in check, it's one of the benefits to the GIC, that actually in many ways has a more direct impact than the number of or the nature of the people we hire. We're not going to alter our organizations that we're going to dramatically change the relationship between full-time and part-time employees. Let's say it's 3% of 200 employees, it's just 6 employees. Or in Jen's case, let's say it's the same, it's 5% of 300 employees, it's 15 employees. Those 21 employees in total as it relates to OPEB, you're not making a meaningful change. If I'm able not to increase health costs by 1% on a $10 million cost, the effect on OPEB could be millions of dollars. So our focus needs to be continue to be making sure that the options available for health insurance are cost effective, that we continue to monitor and work with the GIC to change benefit designs to reflect the industry. That's what's dramatically changed. We all have high deductible. I don't even say our plans on the municipal side are actually not high deductible at $250. There are people with multiple $1,000 deductible plans. And I can tell you 5 years ago, there was not $250 in any plan a municipality offered. Blue Cross plans had no deductibles, so a $50 deductible. So as long as the GIC continues to focus on maintaining and managing its cost and its OPEB by changing the benefit structures to make sure that things like deductibles are consistent with the market, that RX benefits are being properly analyzed, then that's the benefit of being with the GIC, because they're building in the changes that the industry is reflecting to maintain costs. Maintaining the costs of health insurance has a far greater impact than the impact of changing FTE counts, not maybe FTE counts, but in terms of job sharing and part-time. Hey, let me give you a very direct example. Before we went to the GIC, our OPEB was $119 million. The day we switched to the GIC, our OPEB dropped to $81 million. So there's nearly a $40 million change in our OPEB simply by going to a less expensive plan. Now, since that day, it's going to start creeping up a little bit. But our OPEB today, my guess would be $140 or $150 million, where it's $86 million, simply by making the GIC change and the GIC honoring the commitment of changing benefit design to maintain costs. That, to me, is a more important focus around OPEB.
This is why I love working with Andrew Miller.
Thank you.
Very good. Well, thank you very much. We very much appreciated the discussion. It was enlightening, very productive, and thank you. Anyone else have any?
Good lesson, thank you.
For educating.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
More.
Just so you know, Mr. Mealy's planning to come to your next meeting, if that is okay with you guys.
Yeah, we'd love to.
To give you an update on.
Yeah, I was going to ask a question, an update on the situation.
Yes, and he's ready and excited to come, if you'll have him.
Great.
Okay.
He's excited.
He's excited. Well, as excited as Mr. Mealy gets.
Thanks, man.
Have a good night, everyone.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you now.
Thank you for coming.
Terrific. And I think we should devote some time to it. I didn't want to bring it up with Dr. Price and Mr. Mailer just because I haven't had a chance to, I personally haven't had a chance to fully digest it, but I thought it'd be worth it to kind of give it a run through and have you talk about it, and then we can move on to the other items on the agenda.
So we're going to discuss this?
We're going to take a look at it just as it relates to, as we're talking about personnel policies. Why don't we say like 15 minutes to kind of give it a quick run, and then we can digest it later.
We're prepared to really discuss it.
What?
And we're prepared to really discuss it.
I think, yeah.
Okay, then.
What I did, I don't think I'll go into details. And really, all that is anyway in the budget book. It's just
put together in a way where I try to combine different things. I actually realized it would be nice to have these budget books going all the way back to 2005 to actually do a lot more trend development from 2005 to 2014. Right. I only have the details then starting with 2014. And I think that's when these books started, and before that, it's a lot different.
Are always the adopted budgets after town meeting? It all gets, so you get actuals.
Right.
I think we've got that. What you've done here is fantastic.
So, you know, you can do a lot more. So what I did on the first page is just really taking those numbers, total headcount, and then I broke the total headcount into school and town. Mm-hmm. You know, I just named, you know, in these two categories, school and town. You know, that it just tells you that these numbers are increasing, but it doesn't really tell you, you know, is it a good increase or is it a bad increase? So what I tried on the second page is just to put that into the relationship to the population and number of students.
On page two?
On page two. And then you see it's kind of it's a proportional development. So we're not, I mean, you can go into in individual years. Sometimes it's under proportional, sometimes over proportional. But the trend is, you know, it's not, there's not a scissor opening up in one way or the other. So that's what you could say. Plus the census of our population is going back to 2010. I don't know when it gets updated. I'm sure there are new numbers, but they are not in the budget book, and I didn't really start looking for those.
Am I right that, just looking at page two, that between the fiscal years 2011 and 2013, we hired 28 school personnel?
Well, you have to go back to page one. So that is just that chart here is just indexed back to 2005.
So
you can't really see a number out of chart two. Right. So you're going back to chart one.
Yeah. Well, I went to.
On
page
between
two.
Between 11. Those are the numbers. Yeah.
So if you look at the whole time span from 2011 to 2017, we added 39 heads, 30 of which were for school and 9 for town. Mm-hmm. Most of those hires took place between 2011 and 2013.
Mm-hmm.
A fact that I am totally unaware of. Totally unaware of that many hires were made in 11, 12, and 13. I mean, that's huge. So of the 39 heads that we put on from 11 to 17, 28 were hired during this 3-year time period, all of them for the school. Then you take the next time period, which would be 2014 to 2017. There were 9 hires during that time, 2 for the school and 7 for the town.
Yeah.
So I had been pretty much focusing on the time. I mean, Bill, you and I joined this committee back along 2011, 2012.
Right.
We were, I think that was, we had a different chairman at that time. It was a different complexion of the board. I was a complete neophyte. And this hiring got way by me. I just didn't know what was happening.
So why do you think there's a spike beginning in 2011 to 2013?
I have no idea.
So let's talk about 2008. I'm theorizing.
Yeah.
I don't have any facts.
Yeah.
Where people had to shrink. They had to reduce their resources. And I believe what you're seeing here is perhaps a response to all of that retraction to get back up to speed.
But the figures show that there was no huge retraction.
Actually, a little bit, but not much.
Chris might have some insight because he was on the school committee.
We can get into a long discussion on this, but there are probably a couple of factors that we probably feel put this in perspective. This is the period when a couple of things were happening. You had a race to the top. So race to the top was there were funds that communities could get if they put together certain programs that fit this profile. That allowed us to be able to jumpstart a number of programs to bring in teachers that did sort of specialized services for reading, for SPED, and so forth. So we were able, this was the beginning of starting to bring services back, and there was a federal boost for that, which allowed us to do something that otherwise would have been much more damaging to school budgets, which have to cut. We didn't experience cuts because we were able to put together the proposals, the grants, and successfully compete for Race to the Top, which gave us funds to be able to sustain rather than cut. But more importantly, what it allowed us to do is start to bring in-house some of those services, not have to ship students out for SPED. It was all part of really building that foundation. Also, at the same time, you've got to remember that when the economy moved down, the proportion of students that went to prep schools and private schools dropped. There was a pretty big swing in that, so you see that with the student population. So those are, I think, some of the factors. I can't address all of them.
But that was a pretty tough sell for that particular time in that particular FinCom.
But it wasn't a problem. I guess I'm trying to understand what's the problem.
Yeah. We also had, the budgets were also fairly flat. When you look at the budgets themselves.
I think it's a good observation. I missed that when I put these numbers.
No, but I mean,
in those 16 years, or in these 11 years, it's actually happened in 2 years, in the span of 2 to 3 years. Interesting, yeah?
Yeah, so I would say,
it's in the past now, but yeah.
I'm just calling on kind of vague recollections as I was leaving the school committee. That's certainly a question for, Mr. Tracy or actually Mr. Limpert, because he was really on the committee then. But my recollection is it really related to being able to build some services for us.
I think that's also an important table right there. It's, mm-hmm. You would assume that you've got, how much per head? 100,000? You got $3 million of 28 people being hired. But I don't see that kind of jump or delta in there.
Mm-hmm.
And what I'm suggesting is that, and this came up in this meeting, is constantly weighing the benefits of outsourcing or insourcing. Some of that work had to get done, and they didn't do it with their own personnel, they did it by outsourcing.
But Ken, if you maybe look at page 2, mm-hmm. You actually see up to 2011, if you just focus, now you can see this, but if you don't have a color printout, So look at the dark blue, light blue,
mm-hmm.
That's the number of students,
mm-hmm.
Indexed. And then the red one is the headcount of the school. So all the way through 2011, actually was the headcount development in school was under proportional to the number of student mm-hmm. development.
Mm-hmm.
And then it flipped.
Yes.
Because of that massive hiring, it may where it's now over proportional, but I wouldn't say the scissor is really going all the way out. You still see an increase of students from 11, 12, and 13. And really the reason why it's flat, I think those numbers were not updated in the budget. So they stayed flat for 15, 16, and 17 in these in these books. So maybe we'll look at the actual numbers. That blue bar actually could actually go up or maybe even or down. I don't know. I don't have. I just picked those numbers out of the book, you know. So I don't think it's from a development. I'm not so from a proportionalized development. I wasn't too concerned looking at those numbers really. Yeah. I mean, there's an increase of students. There's an increase of population. So that should drive some.
Just a person sitting on it in this seat.
Yeah.
During that time period, it blew my eyes out.
but, you know, I think everything's taken in context. You know, looking in the rearview mirror and all those euphemisms.
Yeah.
You have to take everything into context, and I think when you look at the total budget,
yeah,
year over year, 100%. That's the control.
Right.
That's the overall control. Yeah. The fact that they decided to choose to use the spending on, and by the way, the other thing that's not probably in those numbers in the budget is your grants and those other things, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Well, right. It's not there. And things are a lot more transparent now.
Yes.
I mean, we have these numbers now. Before, we were trying to add up 8s and 20 seconds and 64.56 of FTEs to right. try to figure out what's going on.
Yeah.
You know, Andrew has made all of this information available to us, and so we have a clearer picture than I think we've ever had before
right.
About the number of folks that we have.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, that was just my...
By the way, and to Bill's point as well, they're going through the hiring process. Who's going to be around for the retirement, the OPEB, you know, and mm-hmm. that's that tail of costs. So.
Yeah. Yeah.
So now these are some numbers. If we could go back a couple more years to have it in the same structure as we have it starting in 2014, that would be helpful.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that, so I just used the 14 to 17, basically high level. So, and this is just a general budget, so that does not include the enterprises. So we're spending, now these personnel costs, you have to add up, you know, the salaries per department, the benefits, and. So it took me a while, but it's roughly 68% is, and no surprise, we knew that's the biggest, which is good and bad, you know, good in the sense, you know, if you really have to do something, you know, you can do something really quickly, you know, that those are not fixed in a sense. But then, of course, there's a lot, it's a different component in if you wanna raise that. And also interesting, the headcount only went up by 1% over that time period. But then, of course, the personnel cost went up by 11%.
Right.
And then I broke this actually down into what are the actual wages and salaries.
Mm-hmm.
So they went up over 15%. And what we saw, the employee benefits went actually down in that time period. But that's just the change to the GIC
mm-hmm.
Setup. If you actually break down these employee benefits into the two components, health insurance and retirement, yes, health insurance went down by 9% in that time period,
right.
but it's now going up again. We right. just had that
mm.
yeah.
that dip, but now it's going up. But the retirement went up by 16%, and that will continue going up. So there's an over proportional increase on the retirement side, and we'll see that that this continues.
So you took the growth over a period of from one point to the end point, right?
So yeah,
14% or 11% on the personal.
Right.
But on a compounded basis, it's like 2.7% annually.
Right. Mm-hmm. So that's over 4 years. And then I broke down wages and salary in total, wages and salary in school, wages and salary of town, how that developed, just to see. But they're actually in sync. You know, it's not that school increased more than town.
Right.
And what I did then is...
Which, by the way, that's interesting because there's a discussion going on in the neighboring community about how teacher pay all in when you have steps and so forth, how that really affects the calculation. And what you're showing here is that this is ultimately how much that total pot increases each year, and with the steps and the columns and so forth, all in, the teacher's pay is moving consistent with other municipal employees. I think that's a significant point, that there's consistency together, and I think it draws it out very well.
I broke down the town into public safety, public servicing, admin.
Mm-hmm.
Here you actually see, in the second page, there's actually quite a difference in these sectors. So the last on this one is just the average wages and salary per FTE for the whole school and town. So we're talking 72,000, which is actually the median household income of Massachusetts, $72,000. Now, I don't know if you can compare a salary with a median household income. So I was just trying to see, is that $72,000, mm-hmm. is that, you know, excessive? Is that too low? You know, if you look at the US-wide, it's the median household income is $55,000, but then Massachusetts, of course, is, you know.
And of course, what you have here is an average income.
Yeah.
You have, so you have wage and salary divided by, total wage and salary paid, divided by the number of employees, which is going to give you an average.
An average.
I was wondering what the median would look like, but we have no access to that information.
No, that would be. But what's interesting now, if I break this down, so for the whole town and school together, 72, but when you break it down into the box public safety,
yes,
that surprised me. Or maybe just me, but that's the highest average, and it's really almost 30%, over 30% is driven by overtime and other pay.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think it's probably, for me, that was, you know, for the first time that I saw it. The school is right in the average of that 72. Town administration is a little bit below because you have a lot of lower paid admin job there. You know, if you just looked at the directors, they are probably a little bit higher.
Right.
And then public services by far way down. But now you have the laborers, the foremen, the people on the street with, I guess, in general, a lower pay grade.
So the public service, of course, is just driven by, the public safety is driven by the union piece, police and fire.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's driven by the union contracts.
And the OT.
And the overtime. Which is part of it. How is that overtime? How does a union contract restrictions play into overtime? What's the relationship between the two?
It's very well. You know, it's written. I read all the union contracts on the train on Friday. In fact, I was going to comment to Andrew that, you know, one of the things I noticed and one of the things I was worried about were that some of the contracts used to have some real negative kickers for OPEB. So it was stuff that was easy to give away at the bargaining table because it wasn't coming out of your pocket. So we'll give you $2,000 a year for 3 years in your contract. You know, you can pick 3 years to make an extra $2,000 once. So what's that designed to do? Your final average salary, you know, the average of your final 3 years becomes, you know, the basis for your pension payouts. So basically, we'll give you $2,000 a year. You can get 80% of that $2,000 for the rest of your life, you know, which could be, you know, in the case of public service, you retire at 55, it could be 30 years of, you know, so it's a very expensive giveaway, you know. And Andrew has basically stopped that on the go-forward basis. So the people who have that still have that, but the people who come in now will not get that. So I thought that was a very good thing. But when you look at the contracts as a whole, there's a whole kind of sort of scheme around overtime. Not scheme, but there's a whole sort of philosophical approach to overtime that says, this is when you can get overtime, and this is the list, and this is people who get called in a particular order. It's all based on sort of seniority. So, like, you know, you wait at the end, and that funnels in also to the end of your career. So at the end of your career, you're the person at the top of the list who gets the calls to work the overtime. You know, if someone calls in sick or someone's injured or something, you're the one, you're at the top of the list, you pull all those overtime things. And then your final average salary also happens to boost up, which is
okay. So I think what you're saying is that this construct around the list for the overtime and all of that is custom within a department.
Yes,
it's by custom. Well, and it's just custom.
Right.
Well, maybe it's time to phase that out.
Yeah, well, I mean, those are the things that those
frankly,
are things that get tough around. Those are the things that get tough around contracts.
Well, hey, look, these guys, this is way out of proportion to what everybody else in town is getting. I mean, really.
But it's not out of proportion to what people in other communities.
Right.
Well, you know what? They
so that
ought
goes
to just,
to the same thing.
I mean, maybe the handwriting should be on the wall for them.
But it's I hear where you're going.
Yep.
The balancing act here is that you're negotiating a contract with this, and there are kind of components that are unique to police, unique to fire, unique to teachers. And they're mechanisms that are really there designed to do, you know, reinforce or create opportunities in different ways or recognize expertise in different ways. You know, the way you recognize it for police is different than teachers. So I think the message that I get from Mr. Mailer and I think from Dr. Price is that we're going into these contracts, number one, much more aware of all the ripple effects of it, all the things that feed into it. And secondly, we're recognizing that, as you say, the small piece today gets larger tomorrow, that the other part of it. And so I think it's trying to make sure that when we enter these negotiations, that the management and the people involved in that, you know, come in with that orientation.
And then they chip away a little bit and become more realistic over time, incrementally.
Well, realistic.
But with this business about the custom on the overtime, I mean, that's capable of being phased out by simply saying, okay, we're going to draw the line on people hired after this date are not going to be on the list. I don't know how that.
But you still have to have the concept. You still have to have the concept. There's still going to be people working overtime. Like, you can't say that.
But it's,
there's two choices you could make. You could overstaff to such an extent that you always had somebody available to work regular time, mm-hmm. and meet the staffing levels that are, you know, mandated, that are also part of negotiations in terms of how many officers does it require, right. You know, how many EMTs do you need, how many people do you need for
and
each ladder truck,
half time because et cetera, of the contract,
et cetera, right. et cetera.
Yeah.
And
it
so
is, it's not only
it's
overtime.
Not easy.
Actually, the police and the fire, they have the most accounts under personnel expenses. There's only 20 line items. It's you know, all sorts of different pay. You know, and that adds up to that over 30%.
To the over the 30% for the firefighters, they seem to get more of their overall.
You know, there's holiday pay, vacation pay, sick leave pay, sick time payback.
Those are all contract.
All different. Items. It's all.
They're all contract items.
Yeah.
Okay.
Every
all
single
right.
line
all
item.
Right.
No, but
it's,
I mean,
it's,
I think
you have a point. I mean,
right.
You're absolutely right on the point of okay. that you just have to, you know, you have to go in with the actual data to back up all this stuff. Mm-hmm. And say, like, okay, we can talk about what the overtime policy is, but let's at least say, you know, that $500 is not $500. $500 is 80% of $500 for the next 20 years that gets added into our pension liability. And so we're the ones, you know, we're the biggest contributors to the Essex, you know, county, it's the Essex retirement system. We're the biggest contributors. So we have the most to lose. We, 15%, we have the biggest slice of the pie of that thing. So we bear the biggest part of the liability. We're drawing from it. You know, it's in our interest. You know, in fact, if I were to say, like, pie in the sky, FinCom stuff, what would I want to do?
Mm-hmm.
I would want to get all the other people from the Essex Retirement County and say, what are we going to do total? Because this is a total tragedy of the commons type situation where we can all, you know,
good idea.
Feast on the pension.
Yes.
You know, we can all feast on the pension. We can all push these costs out.
Mm-hmm.
But in the end, they're all coming back.
Yeah.
You know, they're just getting amortized over a certain number of years, and we're going to have an allocation that's going to keep going up. Because when Andrew says, like, the pension will never run out, right, it won't ever run out because we're obligated to foot the bill.
Yes.
You know, like, the bill's going to come every year, and we're going to have to pay it. And the opportunity cost of paying the pension bill is not doing something. It's not hiring that teacher. It's not, you know, replacing those tires on the fire truck. It's all those sorts of things. Those are the tough, you know, sort of decisions. And I think you're absolutely right about, you know, how do we, you know, sort of rationalize some of these things and right-size them. But I think it really does create, like, it's a larger conversation. You know, and some of it's some of it's state law, you know,
do we,
as well.
Is there an well, I mean, at some point we may avail ourselves of what our new legal counsel or some of the finer points, you think, in this, if we pursue it any further?
I think it's, you know, I think it's important. Just, I think that's part of our role is to just say, when we think about, you know, we are not collective bargainers, but we can say, bring all your, you know, what debt are you bringing to the table when you go there to talk about these things? Because, I mean, Chris has been involved.
And yeah, that's absolutely.
Those are the key things you have to, you really have to have your numbers down because, you know, you're going to sit across the table from a guy who's negotiated fire department contracts with 100 municipalities, and he works for the union. So he, you know, not in a bad way. I'm just saying you're dealing with people who are have incredible expertise around a set of issues and a set of working conditions and working rules and so forth. And you really have to, you know, you have to match that firepower with, you know, mass municipal resource research and special things from your town and all sorts of other, you know, I mean, I'm sure the Superintendents Association provides support to school committees and so forth.
But it also really works best when there's a level of trust and confidence to it, because at the end of the day, you know, you're back, ultimately these can get to a place where then it comes to mediation or arbitration with some of them. Some unions, you don't have that. You never want to be in an adversarial situation where the two parties say, we're never going to give this up, and this party says, you got to give it up. And so that's part of, you know, what I hear from Mr. Miller, what I hear from Dr. Price is that is the basis of the,
yes.
the all of this. So there are going to be pieces of this that are in there. But at the end of the day, I think shining a little light on that is good for people to understand, but recognize, yeah, there are going to be some artificial components to this that you kind of scratch your head and say, well, that's part of the deal.
Mm-hmm.
But let's recognize it for what it is, right?
Mm-hmm. And I think by having discussions like this, if anyone is watching at home in TV land, they will know that their FinCom is looking at these issues and scratching their heads and considering their complexities and shining some light.
It is complex.
Okay. Yeah.
The next slide, the school headcount, I just broke down, and that was actually the starting point of our exercise. You know, who are the categories of employees do we have? And in the school, it's fairly simple, so I broke it down into a teaching bucket, and I put the teachers, obviously, but also the professionals, it's a spelling and aides. It's the 85% of the are actually teaching, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. at the kids, and then 15% I put in the administration, including the superintendent, custodians, and nurses in, let's say, non-teaching, which is 15%, and really nothing changed over those 4 years. Those ratios
are the same.
Are the same.
Yeah.
Also, I just took the numbers of students divided through the school FTE, it's around 10. The number of students divided through teachers FTE, it's around 12. I mean, that number doesn't say anything. The only thing is that there's no change in the development. It's not up, it's not down. It's just...
The one
so it's pretty boring, that development over the last 4 years. It might change now with the new superintendent.
There's kind of a layer to this that you don't see here, but Mr. Mealy could provide for you, which might provide a little insight, which is the number of teachers that don't have professional status, those that are less than 3 years. Has that shifted? Is that shifted?
That's an interesting
point. How many are at the top step? In other words, they're only... salary increase would be a negotiated cost of living. Those tell you a little bit about who your teachers are, what your retention levels are. Also, there may be some other things to kind of read into that. So, you know, 481 teachers, you know, could look very different depending upon the composition of that. They could drive underneath that, but.
Right.
Your analysis shows one part of it.
You can kind of see why I was choking on these custodians. Yeah. 27?
Well, seven,
well,
eight schools.
Help me.
That's a lot of schools.
Seven schools, right?
Yeah.
Oh.
Well, you know, if you're early childhood, you got eight.
Yeah.
You really had eight.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
And the high school is, you know, 250, gigantic. Several hundred thousand square feet, so.
I always go back, Karen, to my belief in the overall management of the budget. It's kind of crazy the last handful of years. Mm-hmm. And I also, we've got some great leadership over the last 5 years. Prior superintendent, current superintendent, Andrew. And if they could shift.
They would have.
People from custodian to teacher, they would. If they're not going to reduce it and throw it away.
I'm just thinking of outsourcing some of it, you know. But we've had part of that discussion. It just seems like an awful lot of.
Everyone knows their custodian.
I know it.
All
right.
I would agree that it would be something worth looking at. But then, you know, because I do it, and you know, I've been in that exact position where, you know, I got to the point where we had a cleaner at night, paid him, he came in. All of a sudden, we just had too many people and too many square feet to do it, and you know, to employ one person over 8 hours, you know, a lot of which people were there, he just couldn't be efficient anymore. So it just got to the point where he had to start his day at like 2. He was working 2 to 10, right? So for the first 3.5-4 hours he was there, he was stepping around people. He couldn't turn on the vacuum. You know, he couldn't really walk around. He would start cleaning some stuff. It would get messed up and so forth. And then I got to the point where I said, okay, I'm going to outsource it. But I was able to outsource it and do it at night and have people who came in for 4-hour shifts. And it was less expensive overall because if you, you know, I mean, this is what corporate America does. If you pay somebody for 4 hours and they're non-benefit, you know, they're non-benefit, they're fairly low wage, they cycle through a lot, so you lose some of the continuity. But you have the advantage of, you know, you never, with a cleaning contract, you never have to pay overtime. But with those prevailing wages things step in, that would really upend the entire model because, you know, the entire model of my outsourcing my janitorial was you can find somebody to clean offices for $11 or $12 an hour in a 4-hour shift with no benefits.
So I mean, we did the opposite. Yeah. So at the facilities my company runs, they kind of operate like multifamily, but they're for seniors. We actually combined the position for janitorial with kind of our maintenance tech, who's kind of like our handyman. So I don't know who does that kind of work. And if there's in particular for the schools, I like in general the idea of your students or your people understanding who's in their school, especially around our children, and not just necessarily having a cleaning company. Mm. Yeah, of course, if it's at night, that's somewhat of a different story.
Right.
And for the towns, maybe a different story. But I'm wondering if there's some ability to kind of combine positions or keep them in a way that if we're going to have someone full time, they're maybe doing a little bit different work.
Custodians aren't. Well, it's part of the job,
but it's not.
They do a whole lot. They're the handyman.
Yes.
Right.
I will tell you, and one little inside baseball on this was another pop. Mr. Mealy, before he was involved in schools, he managed the DPW in New Hampshire. I can't remember the town. That's where he and Mr. Hoddle. And I can still remember vividly he coming into a meeting and having this discussion about the early childhood center and about what it would take to do that. And because of his experience in working on the municipal side, he had all the analyses about how much time it took and all those. So you have somebody who's sitting there in the school who's, you know, responsible for the budget, who actually has municipal experience with some of those sort of things. So again, if he's comes in the next week or two, you can ask him that. But that you actually have kind of a unique expertise of somebody here who really did the analysis and say, here's what it took. It's right. Better, it's more efficient for us to hire somebody than it was to outsource. And I still remember the whole calculation because he broke it all down for us.
Right.
Really impressive.
And then you add in, like, you know, in my office situation, you know, we had a security guard, which allowed us to outsource to a certain extent because you had that element there, that there was someone, you know, minding the gate.
Yeah.
You know, whereas if you have someone who's gone through a rigorous full-time hiring process, and you know, like cleaners in union buildings in New York, they never leave. They have a union cleaning job. They will stay there for 20 or 30 years. I mean, you could leave, and this would happen all the time, people would say, you know, I left my watch on my desk, and I go to the cleaners, I know they took it, and I would say, listen, I said, I am not going near those cleaners, I'm not even gonna bring that question to them until you know, for 48 hours. I'll document that you came to me, that you lost your watch, that you can't find your watch, and you're positive you left it right on your desk for the day, and you went home, and the cleaners were in there in between, and then you showed up the next day, and it wasn't there. I said, but give me 48 hours. I was like, I'm just not going to do that, because I've been working with these guys for years. And every single time, they would find it. Oh, my friend took it and put it in his drawer when I left, you know, or something else. Because that's a real thing, because you're talking about children and other sorts of people, you know, and you do get that, and you can't, you know, outsourcing doesn't get you the loyalty and sort of the, you know, and like just operationally, the ability to go through a closing routine, to understand how to escalate, you know, to be able to communicate issues. I mean, those are all things that have a certain cost, you know. So in the right structure, like cleaning a big office building, if you have a custodian there, someone on site supervising, they all check in, they all check out, you know, that can work. But, you know, to throw a crew of cleaners into a building with no supervision, you know, just doesn't, especially given all the like vetting requirements and so forth, just doesn't work.
But you develop a relationship, right, over a period of time, even if you outsource work.
Right. Yeah, you can, but that usually, that comes at a price too, so, you know.
If they're a strong, like if it's a strong company, but you mm-hmm. don't have the ability to win loyalty the same way I think you would with an employee. Yeah.
Right. And you lose in one sense, you gain a lot of control in that you can switch companies. A lot of times you can tell the vendor, like, I'm not happy with this person, bring someone else, and it's not a personnel action, you know, because on the flip side of a bad municipal employee or a bad employee with any sort of protections like that, it does take a long time to, because I don't think the private sector is that much more efficient in sort of taking care of performance issues. Mm-hmm. They're a lot quicker to cut people for non-performance related reasons, but it's still sort of a process that takes time, and you know, and that's, so I mean there is that side to it too, that, you know, there are always a few bad apples in any box.
Sidetracked, sorry.
Yeah, I know.
Town. So that now we have a few more categories. So what I did, and really all the following pages is all the detail. I'm not going to go there. That's actually the summary of all these departments. I mean, there are numerous departments. And what I tried to do is sort the headcount for town into management. Mm-hmm. Now we could argue if you want to have the lieutenant and sergeants as a manager, but I threw them in there. So we have obviously all the directors, the chiefs, and the deputy chiefs, so the town managers in the first line. Then so we have 18, I went up and went down a little bit. We have 11 lieutenants, fairly stable over those 4 years. Eight sergeants, fairly stable, and around nine managers, fairly stable over that time. So overall, 46, 47 in management, and then non-management, that's all the admins, and now there are at least 20 categories, payroll, assistant, payroll, admin, so I'd summarize them all under admin, so I'm, otherwise you get then line items with one and two people, and then that doesn't really say anything, so I consolidated that, and that's the only obvious here, that the number of admins actually increased over those 4 years. That's the only block. Firefighters unchanged, police unchanged, so any non-sergeant, lieutenant, or chief. We have a small increase for foremen, but really it's nothing, it's just a high percentage, but it's a half a, or it's one FTE. And then actually, as Andrew said, yeah, we have only two engineers. They are considered engineers in that budget book. Yeah, I was also surprised about that. And I guess they're just, you know, handing out to these subcontractors all the engineering work. So again, fairly stable. The only thing I would say is
for me, and Andrew said, you know, they're very lean and flat, that's possible. There are two things. First, I think the management to staff is a low ratio in general, you know. Companies that are typically higher. And the amount of departments we have, you know, we have a director development is a director, has two or three people, you know, director for health service, director for here, director for there. You know, do you really need 20, 25 different departments? Mm. I guess that's how it's organized. And that's why you have a fairly high number of management and not so many, you know, staff, because they are small departments typically. You know?
Right.
Mm-hmm. There are three or four at the most. And all the details are now on the following pages, you know. Yeah. There's not a like a 20-person department.
Right.
So the, in business, it would be 6 to 10.
Well, yeah, I just Googled, it's difficult to compare, you know.
So the line that says on this page 7, that total headcount thing?
Yeah.
Let's see, from the bottom, it says manager/non-management. Would you flip that the other way for math reasons?
Okay. You're right.
Okay.
Should be the other way.
Okay.
It's, yeah. Free non-management for per manager. Okay. You're right.
Okay.
I guess I thought about the header after I did the calculation. You're right.
Okay.
All of you.
So, you know, we could argue that it's maybe how it's organized. And then a lot of details. Where you see all these little departments. Maybe the public safety, but there are three departments, fire, police, and health. But then on the public services, public works, facility, library, elder service, I don't know how they organize that. It's just grouped that way, and I just took that over. And then you have the administration part, the IT, town clerk, treasurer, and all that.
And then I think since we've been focused on personnel, the note about the levy, I think maybe we should say, you know, unless you want to have like a 2 minutes on that, and I think we should. In all fairness to everybody, try to wrap it up fairly soon.
Can we just continue this discussion at another meeting?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Sure.
Okay.
Yeah,
I would like to do that simply because we're getting to some very interesting figures here with administration.
Right.
But I would like.
Just in case somebody's wondering how I calculate or what that is. I just came across, I put a couple of numbers together, and that stuck out the most. And I still don't know exactly if it's a good thing or not, but it just is pretty interesting.
Yeah.
So what I did, there is, I think they call it a max levy.
Right.
And that is 2.5% on the assessed value.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
It's just roughly $4.2 billion for the town. I don't know if it's done yearly.
It's done yearly.
The number was not updated for 2017. That's why it's flat.
Right.
And you see this is in blue, indexed to 2005.
Right.
First it went up, and then it went down because we had, you know, the property values went up, and then there was the crisis, and then the property values basically went down, and now they're kind of, you know, going up. So there is over those 11 years not much movement. You have the dip and it came down, so our max levy. But actually what the actual levy then indexed went up quite significantly over time from 45, and that's just the residential property tax, from 45 million to, I think we're now at 70 million or
right.
something like that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I just put that into relation of to each other. So what is the max levy, which was pretty flat, but the actual levy actually went up every year, our 2.5%. And what I called it, so we're getting closer and closer to our max levy, was the max levy in 2007 90 million? We used 45 million. Now the levy, the max is still around 100 million, but now we're at 70 million. So we're getting closer and closer to that max levy. And when you reach that, then you need, I don't know, what's called overrides and all that fun stuff.
Is that what that is then? So when you reach your max levy, it's override time?
Don't think that's the approach.
That's more, I think this is a kind of more nuanced decision. I was at that meeting, a number of us were at that meeting. I think what Garrett went through, there's some subtleties to it.
Oh, you might
in terms
like to
of
have that.
Trend and so forth. But your point being is that the capacity of hitting that max 2.5, we've used up a lot of runway towards that, as have many communities in Massachusetts, which just points to the fact of there's not a lot of low-hanging fruit in terms of taxing opportunities. It's really about growth that's going to make your community
That's
work.
The base, the tax base
the
needs
thing?
To go up. And why I put this still on there, because we have accounts like retirement, like healthcare, they're growing faster than 2.5%.
Right.
Now, assume we have 2.5% inflation for our headcount, which is roughly 70% of our cost. And then you have all the other costs going up more than 2.5%. So you either grow your tax base to make up that you can afford that other stuff, or you have to cut some, or you have overrides and whatever. Now I'm getting into where I don't really understand too much.
That's I think the fundamental thing with municipal finance, that you're dealing with these big costs that are rising. You know, I mean, the personnel costs you can manage, and I think it's kind of like chicken and egg. You know, I have friends who live in like Westchester County and Connecticut and so forth without Prop 2.5, and they've certainly seen tax increases, you know, well beyond, and their property taxes are fairly onerous. Because they don't have that sort of governor. So it's almost like you wonder, you know, but for Proposition 2.5, where would we be? I don't think that I, in 1979, would have gone out and said this is a great thing.
No.
It's certainly, you know, certainly a tool that municipalities have in bargaining with labor unions and say, like, you want more than 2.5? We can't do that. I mean, so that's one part. Well, that's one side of the equation. But the other part is that now, I mean, back then, healthcare costs were, I mean, I'd love to go back to a budget from 1992 and look at what healthcare costs were. I'm sure the number was, like, minuscule. You know, I mean, all these years of 7 to 10.
So all these costs will go up. Shouldn't we focus on generating more funds now? And that's why it goes back to the planning and the master planning, where we should focus on how we can generate more income to the town so that we can offset this.
Absolutely.
You're absolutely right.
You're here, as they said.
If that would be it.
It's tough because it's, you know, you only have a secondary or tertiary effect. Like, we're never going to get any closer to Boston. We're never going to get any more open land, you know. Like, I went to a presentation on sort of the life sciences. What do you need to put up a life sciences building? You need like tons and tons of water. You need excellent sewer. You need low electric rates. You know, I mean, how many of those things do we have control over? Like, very, very few. You know, I mean, then that's the tricky part. And then if you have, you know, and then you have the whole idea that, you know, not every private enterprise is going to run to its highest and best use either. That
I think that's part of what, you know, the planning perspective.
Right. Yes, master so plan,
how do we get the highest and best use for the land we have available that also increases our tax base?
So the master plan that is done is not tied.
So you're under competition.
Competitive, which is good.
And and we see all these, you know, high level out in the news. You know, you get $7 million, so you can keep 200 people, you know, employed. Now that's gonna, you know, it's getting more and more expensive to get a company. I mean, they know there is. If you look at that, you know, as a company, you have actually you're on a you have
Leverage. You need me actually to maintain your current living, the standard of living. If that continues, if you can't increase your tax base, you've got to cut your headcount over time, because that's the only way to cope with that situation, unless you you increase taxes and over proportionally.
But headcount is, you got to remember, headcount is connected to the service delivery, and I think that's the one thing. Although we are the FinCom, those numbers represent people, represent services that are being delivered. So the real impact is, yes, you may balance the ledger, but how do you really affect the community? And I think that's the other part of the discussion, that's what we heard from Mr. Mailer. So
the balancing
it. I think this is really good, because it kind of puts that in mind to say, if we've got to make some choices, recognize how that's going to play out. It's going to play out in either our pockets or level of service or some combination of those, but we need to be prepared to always recognize that's part of this. Yeah. Excellent.
So we can't, I mean, you've done such a wonderful job of pulling all this information together. I would hate to lose the benefit of it in any way. And we may decide after further discussion that we would like to have you tweak it in some way. Are you game for this? I don't even know. For instance, you might tweak it to take out the union employees out of some of the categories. You're looking at me like...
No, I'm just listening.
Like it, when we do the administration part, you include the fire chiefs in with yes, all of the other chiefs of all of the other departments. You might consider making two pages of that, or separating them out, because they're different because they've got these contracts associated with them. We really don't have that kind of control.
The thing is, I don't have that information, so but I base everything on here, and that's not in there. So if we want to tweak it, we need the link for that.
It's not tweakable. Okay.
No,
all right.
I mean, I don't have access to it.
And I think it'd be more accurate, at least more helpful, to compare apples to apples, not apples to oranges. So to look at other communities and see exactly what those specific departments are paying, or you know, how that's impacting their community versus the different departments across the board in North Andover in particular, because it's sometimes not comparable.
Exactly. May I just be off topic for a minute?
Sure.
The FinCom, I'm backing into it. The FinCom actually has a budget. I think our budget right now is $755. I don't know what it's for.
There's snow removal.
I have attended for the last 2 years the Mass Municipal Association annual meeting. I would think that some of you would like to do the same thing. It's really very eye-opening to talk with selectmen and FinCom members from other communities across the Commonwealth, from Cape Cod, how they're handling their water problems, to other folks, never mind the constitutional officers who come from time to time, and it's kind of nice to be able to chat with them. What I'm suggesting is that perhaps we can consider asking for an increase in our budget, FinCom budget, that might allow some of us or all of us to attend this annual meeting. I can fill you in on more of what such a budget request might look like at our next meeting, and we could discuss it.
Sure.
If you would. I think there's a...
That's a great idea.
All right. Thank you. It's just that, you know, I've been doing this on my own hook because I found it fascinating. others might find it fascinating if there was a little reimbursement for your hook.
Sure.
So, all right.
Great.
Okay.
Okay, do we have a motion?
Oh, wait a minute, we didn't do the minutes.
I know. Can we just postpone? I move that we postpone the minutes till
you can't do that.
Next meeting because I'm exhausted.
Second it. All in favor.
Yeah, right.
All in favor.
Aye. Okay.
Yeah.
Aye.
Fair enough.
I also need a motion to end to adjourn the meeting.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Seconded by Nobly and was unanimous.